Welcome to the James River campus of Pioneer Baptist Church. Let's stand and worship together. Good morning. Hey, welcome to the James River campus. If you're online, welcome. We're glad you're here as well. Do me a favor, just look around you for a second. Reach your hand out. Let someone know how good it is to see them this morning. All righty. Hey, if we could grab a seat, I just have a couple of things I want to share with you. So first I wanted to go ahead and throw it out there, and I know Pastor Tom's going to address it a little later today, and that has to do with his letter that many of you received this week, that he's going to be resigning in October. And I know that that really came as quite a shock to a lot of people, but, you know, I've known Pastor Tom for 7-8 years, and I can tell you that he's going to stay local. He's actually got an opportunity to go back to what he was doing before, and that's going out and encouraging and equipping pastors all over the southern part of Virginia. So he's going to be out and about doing his thing. And quite honestly, I'm excited for him because God's going to do something new in and through him. And anytime there's an ending, there's a beginning. And I believe that God's going to do something really awesome and beautiful through Bon Air Baptist Church as well. And so, again, I'm excited for him. I remember when he first came, he said to me one time, well, I was walking down the hall with him, and some man walked up, and he said, well, hey, Pastor, how long do you think you'll be here? And he said, oh, until the next guy comes. And, you know, the truth is, we're all kind of here until the next guy or gal comes. And wherever you're at, I mean, the same applies there, too. So, you know, I want to celebrate with him. And some of you came to the baseball game this week, and him and his wife, Paula, were able to join us. So it was a great time. We had a lot of fun. And, again, I think that we can get shocked. We can get dismayed or whatever we want to, but at the end of the day, Jesus is still on the throne, and we're going to get together, we're going to worship him and celebrate him, and we'll just continue on. One other thing I had for you is about the baptisms that are coming up. That's September the 11th. If you have an interest in being baptized, if you could see me at some point and we'll have a conversation. If you're online, you can go to bonairbaptist.org/baptism, and we will connect with you there. So anyways, a lot of things going on. It's a good day today, and it's supposed to be beautiful outside. And my hope is that we all have an opportunity to simply take some time this morning and worship the one who created it all. Would you pray with me? Father, we thank you for this opportunity to gather here today. And Lord, as we've heard Pastor Tom's news this week, we certainly as a congregation will miss him, but Father, we celebrate with him as well because we know that through him, you're going to do a new thing. So Lord, as we worship this morning, help us to just be centered around that which we've come to do today. And that's one thing, that's to worship you. So may all the words we sing, the scriptures that we hear, the gospel that's proclaimed, may it simply just point us towards you. Father, we love you, we worship you, we give you all the praise, glory, and honor. And it's in Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Let's continue to worship. The psalmist writes in Psalm 34, your praise will ever be on my lips. Let's make that our prayer this morning. Strength becomes Blessed is God, and what a blessing He is. He's the Father of our Master, Jesus Christ, and takes us to the high places of blessing in Him. Long before He laid down earth's foundations, He had us in mind, had settled on us as the focus of His love, to be made whole and holy by His love. Long, long ago, He decided to adopt us into the family through Jesus Christ. What a pleasure He took in planning this. He wanted us to enter into the celebration of His lavish gift-giving by the hand of His beloved Son. It's in Christ that we find out who we are and what we are going to be living for. Long before we heard of Christ and got our hopes up, He had His eye on us. He had designs on us for glorious living, part of the overall purpose He's working out in everything and everyone. It's in Christ that you, once you heard the truth and believed it, the message of your salvation, you found yourselves home free, signed, sealed, and delivered by the Holy Spirit. This down payment from God is the first installment of what's coming, a reminder that we'll get everything God has planned for us, a praising and glorious life in Christ alone.
I
Amen. Have a seat, please. All right. Hey, I just wanted to circle back to one thing here, if I could, real quick, and that has to do with communication. When I mentioned a little earlier about some news that had gone out, I saw some surprised looks, and I just want to encourage you, if you are here this morning or if you're online and you would like to sign up for our email newsletter, if you go to jrc@bonairbaptist.org, to that email address, jrc@bonairbaptist.org, we can just say, sign me up for the email. And every week, we just send out an email newsletter about what's coming up, what's going on, this coming week's message, and any information or things that we need to share. The other way that you can connect is by going to your cell phone and starting a text message and typing in 804-409-2080. That's 804-409-2080. And we'll send out links and stuff like that. And if you're already subscribed, you got one this morning probably that said, hey, good morning, we can't wait to see you at 10 a.m. So these are the ways we're trying to stay connected with each other. You know, before we got into the summer, we were in the process of having some community conversations. And we had some great conversations about, you know, now that we find ourselves living in this quasi-post-COVID world and everything's kind of changed, and for us to expect things to go back maybe to exactly the way they were was unrealistic. So we were gathering and having these conversations during the week about how can we best maximize, or how can we best situate ourselves to maximize our impact for God's kingdom around this community. And a lot of great things came out of those meetings, and I want to encourage you this coming Wednesday at 6:30, we're going to gather here. We'll also have an opportunity for you to join by Zoom. I realize that it's like, wow, that's only 3 days away, but in light of the news that we've heard, we just want to continue these conversations and not let it be something that gets lost. So if you can join us, we'd love for you to be a part of that. We'll send it out in the email newsletter, and we'll also send out a text that day reminding you, and we'll have a Zoom link on it as well. It's an interesting time, but I do believe, as I said at the beginning, with every ending comes a new beginning, and you know, God can do big things through two things at one time. So that's exciting. Today we're going to continue in this sermon series we're in on these parables of Jesus, these short stories that are long in meaning. And if you have your Bible, we're going to take a look at Matthew chapter 25, verses 1 through 13. And this is the parable of the 10 virgins. I'll begin reading here at verse 25. At that time, the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 virgins who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. Five of them were foolish, and five were wise. The foolish ones took their lamps, but did not take any oil with them. The wise ones, however, took oil in jars along with their lamps. The bridegroom was a long time in coming, and they all became drowsy and fell asleep. At midnight, the cry rang out, "Here comes the bridegroom, come out to meet him." Then all the virgins woke up and trimmed their lamps. The foolish one said to the wise, "Give us some of your oil, our lamps are going out." "No," they replied, "there may not be enough for both of us and you. Instead, go to those who sell oil and buy some for yourselves." But while they were on their way to buy the oil, the bridegroom arrived. The virgins who were ready went in with him to the wedding banquet, and the door was shut. Later, the others also came. "Lord, Lord," they said, "open the door for us." But he replied, "Truly I tell you, I don't know you. Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know the day or the hour." So again, this is another one of these stories that Jesus shared with his followers to help illustrate these spiritual truths. Our message today is titled, "By Failing to Prepare, We Are Planning to Fail." So we're going to go ahead now and join with our Buford Road campus and hear from Pastor Tom.
Let me say good morning to our brothers and sisters at the James River campus and Pastor John there, to those gathered at the Buford Road campus. Pastor Mac is away. His father was getting married this week, and so he's there celebrating with his family. And to those of you online, we are glad that you're joining us here today. Before I begin my message to you today, I want to ask that you allow me just to kind of address the elephant in the living room, if you will. If you're a member of Bonnier Baptist Church, then you received a letter in your home this week announcing my resignation as of October 16th. If you are not a member of the church, but you have been a faithful attender, I'm resigning to take a position with the Virginia Baptist Mission Board, Baptist General Association of Virginia, as a resource consultant for churches in the Southside region while we continue to live here in Midlothian. And so it is that we're entering into a phase over these next 2 months, a phase of closure. And so I want to let you know that there'll be several things that are happening during this phase to keep you well informed as the body of Christ here at Bonaire. First and foremost, Church Council will be communicating with you regarding the next steps in terms of interim, who will be filling the pulpit, and about the pastor search process beginning. Secondly, I would encourage us, all of us, to have, during this time of interim, what I would call a situational awareness. What I mean by that is the moment that I made this resignation public, that essentially this happens in every church when a pastor leaves, whether for good reasons or bad, these four groups begin to emerge. The first group are those who are extremely sad. They're heartbroken. They don't really see a vision of how the church can move forward without its pastor. And so they're sad. Their energy level is pretty low at this moment. There's a second group made up of those who are excited to see me go. They would say to you, "Not soon enough. Took you long enough to hear the word of the Lord. Get on out the door. Don't know why you stayed as long as you did." Their energy level tends to be pretty high. The third group is made up really of portions of the first and second, in that they are both sad and happy. They're sad to see me leave as their pastor, but they're also happy about the future because they understand this is a part of life. Pastors come and go. Every pastor, in a sense, is an interim because they do not last forever. And so it is, they have some, their energy level's kind of moderate, sad in the moment, but looking forward to a bright future. My personal favorite group is the fourth group. They're the ones who will call the church office about 6 months from now after I'm gone and say, would you mind having Pastor Tom come visit me in my home? Because they don't have a clue what's going on. I share that with you to say if we can have some situational awareness, then we can permit each other some grace, no matter which group we're in, to allow each other to be where we are, knowing that we're still the body of Christ together under this umbrella called the Bon Air Baptist Church. That's strong enough to make the lights go out. Yes, Lord, yes. Some of you will read that one way. I read it completely another way. Wow. Where was I? It was some 8+ years ago that Paul and I came to walk with you and begin our journey. God has called me to another position, and it is with great sadness that I leave you as lead pastor, and with great joy that I'm stepping into the next phase of my journey, our journey as a family with the Baptist General Association of Virginia, and would suggest that you may have the same, that there is sadness and joy, but Bon Air Baptist Church is heading into her own phase. Where the Lord is already at work. Let me assure you, He knew this was coming long before any of us. Long before any of us. And He has prepared you for this time and this season that is now upon you. I want to say this. I will honor the next 2 months that I am with you with all that I have. I think there's much that we can look forward to. We've got a 70th anniversary on October 2nd where all of our campuses will be together here at 10 o'clock in the morning to worship together. We have one of the most exciting mission partnerships that we're going to launch in October with Food for the Hungry. One of the most incredible opportunities to relate to a community like none I have ever been a part of. And in addition, September will bring the new year in terms of the church year, fall discipleship classes. And there's a multitude of them, and you received information, I hope, about some of those this morning or on the website. So with all that having been said, I want to make the transition to my message today by saying with all that is within me that God is up to more than we will ever know.
Thank you, Tom. We love you.
Let me get busy and preach. God is good and all the time. So for those of you who know me, when it comes to driving, I am all about the destination. I've got no really interest in the journey at all. I'm about expediency. I'm about when I call up the map on my GPS and it says you will arrive at this time, I snicker to myself, thinking there's no way I'm arriving that late. And so the race begins against the GPS. Can I get a witness? Anybody out there? No, I have no plans to make a restroom stop. Right? So that begins with an announcement to the girls in my home. Now, use the restroom now before we get in the car. Well, having lived in Roanoke, Virginia for 26 years and traveling Highway 220 south out of there towards Greensboro, you go through Rocky Mount. There is a billboard there. It's been there for years. I'm going to assume that it's still there. It is huge. It stands above the highway. You cannot miss it. And it says in huge, bold, red letters, be prepared to meet Jesus. Every time I see it, I hit the brakes. And I immediately began scanning all my front mirrors, side mirrors, thinking, am I going to be in a wreck right now? I mean, every time it catches me off guard, be prepared to meet Jesus. Well, today's parable is about that one thing, being prepared. Being watchful, being vigilant, being alert, being prepared to meet Jesus when He comes again. It actually is this call to the Boy Scouts motto, be prepared. Today's the last in our series of the journey through the parables. I thank you for your patience. It has been wonderful for me to preach them as the Lord has grown me through this series. I hope He has you. These earthly stories with a heavenly meaning, stories that Jesus told thousands of years ago that are as prevalent today as they were then when He first spoke them. These kind of stories that challenge you and challenge me as His listeners. Get ourselves in the story. Listen to what God would say to you and to me as we play out this parable stories that were so really simple, using everyday objects and occurrences and events to explain deep, spiritual, profound thoughts. Parables are short stories, but I hope we've learned together they are long on meaning. Meaning for your life and my life. I love the story Pastor told about a couple in his congregation, Bob and Betty. They were wonderful models of a Christian marriage and what it meant, but Bob and Betty had a problem. They were late for everything. It didn't matter what it was. If it was something at church, worship, small group, Sunday school, potluck, it didn't matter. Even in their own life, late for appointments, it didn't matter. They were just late. Well, it seems that Bob contracted cancer and he died, and so it came time for the funeral. And on the day of the funeral director came running in from outside into the pastor's office and said, "We've got a problem. Betty won't get out of the limo to come inside." So the pastor went out thinking that she was struggling, not wanting to accept the finality of her husband's death. So he pleaded with Betty to get out of the limo, and she said, "I'm not doing it. I'm not doing it." And finally, after a few minutes passed, she looked at her watch and she said, "Okay," with teeth clenched, she said, "Okay, I'm ready to go. You see, what you don't understand is that man made me late for everything for 45 years because he waited to the last minute to prepare, and I refused to be on time for his funeral." Well, so Jesus is going to introduce this example of preparing in terms of a wedding, an everyday occurrence during his time, to teach listeners about being prepared for the kingdom of God. Understand that weddings in Jesus' time were even bigger deals than they are now. One of the biggest celebrations of the village and of social life, the couple would become the center of the village life for sometimes days and even weeks on end around the wedding itself. And as you can imagine, at the end of the wedding ceremony, there was great dancing and celebrating and revelry, which could last for several days. But a Jewish wedding in that day consisted of three phases. The first phase was the engagement. Now, this really wasn't a time where he would get out on his knee and ask his bride to be, "Will you marry me?" No, this was the time when fathers of the bride and fathers of the bridegroom would come together and negotiate this marriage about what that was going to look like. So it really wasn't so much an agreement between two people as it was a financial agreement between two families. So this was the engagement. The second phase was the betrothal. This was the time in which the bride and groom actually exchanged their vows. They were officially married at that moment. However, they did not go to a place and live together. They did not go anywhere and consummate this marriage. No, the husband would leave the betrothal, the wedding ceremony, where the vows had been given, and he would go to prepare a place for his bride and himself. Now, in that day and time, usually that meant adding on an extra room to his father's house. And so when the time came that that little room or the addition or the house was then ready and approved by the father of the groom, then we would move to the last phase, this third phase. The groom would go to the house of his bride and he would walk her in this procession towards the house that he had prepared for her. And so this procession from the house of the bride to now their house together would usually take place at night. And so the imagery here is that as the bridegroom comes to take his bride to their new home, the pathway at night would be lit by these torches. You can imagine rags dipped in oil lighting the night. There would be others too, but the important ones were the bridesmaids who would light the path. These were young women who were expected. They had the expectation, the privilege, the honor of being ready to light the path. And here's an important point. They were to be prepared for this event, not knowing the day, nor the time, nor the hour when the bride and the bridegroom were coming. See, this was all about preparation. So while waiting every day, they were to use every day making sure they were prepared for what may come that night or may not. They didn't know the time or the hour when the bride and the bridegroom would come. And so with this in mind, now having the context of the parable, the problem is introduced, Jesus says. There were 10 bridesmaids. 5 of them were ready. 5 of them had all the oil they needed by bringing extra whatever they needed, and then there were 5 who were not. And he introduces them as foolish. in verse 8. The foolish one said to the wise, "Give us some of your oil. Our lamps are going out." "No," they replied. "There may not be enough for both of us and you. Instead, you go to those who sell oil and buy some for yourselves." But while they were on their way to buy the oil, the bridegroom arrived. The virgins who were ready went in with him to the wedding banquet, and the door was shut. And the door was shut. Let's keep this painfully poignant parable as simple as it really is and to the point. Jesus is the bridegroom in this parable. The bride is you, me, his church, the believers who he is going to come and take one day to the place, to the home he has prepared. Remember in the story? That is heaven for us. The oil is representative of the Holy Spirit. And so in the parable, the question is, will we be ready? Will we be prepared with plenty of Holy Spirit living in us when Jesus comes to take us home? We cannot give someone else our salvation and the presence of the Holy Spirit. Each person must receive salvation for himself or herself. And we understand here at the end that the door is shut, meaning God's judgment is really irreversible, irrevocable. And that's why that door is going to be shut. Doesn't matter how loud people holler, "Lord, Lord," he'll say, I didn't know you." Two things strike me about this parable. First, I'm kind of thrown off the first time I read it by the bridesmaids who were prepared. And this kind of question by those who were not prepared, hey, we're going to run out of oil. Can you loan us some of your oil? I mean, I would think innocently that Christians are meant to what? Share? So share a little bit of oil here. But no, they just say, "No, you need to go get your own." And Jesus is making a very clear point here that when the time comes for his return, at that moment, it's too late. It's too late. It's too late to say, hold on just a minute, Lord. Let me go get prepared. Let me go do what I need to be doing. Let me go do what I knew I should have been doing all along. The door will be shut. Because we can't give to others the Holy Spirit that we have received that will enable us when the time comes to be able to go with the Lord. Others have to receive that on their own. I found an article this week by Aaron Loy that really speaks to this. The title of it was "Really Bad Reasons That People Leave Their Church." Really bad reasons why people leave their church. The first two, I believe, have great resonance with this particular parable. The first, he says, the number one bad reason for leaving the church is the one most given by people when they leave a church. And here's the reason. "I'm not being fed." They announce that, "I'm not being fed." Well, in light of today's parable, we might rephrase that to say this: I'm not getting enough of someone else's oil. Hello, anybody home? Mr. Loy responded to this reason in his article by saying this, and I quote, "To leave a church because you're not getting enough substance is a cop-out. Your primary call to the church is to contribute, not to consume. As a Christian, you shouldn't require spoon feeding for the rest of your life. Eventually, you need to learn how to feed yourself so that in time, you will feed others. Remember, your call is not just to be a disciple, but to make disciples." Here's the second reason he gives of why people, bad reasons why people leave the church. This is their statement: "My needs aren't being met here. My needs aren't being met." I need to say this to you. This might help you in terms of this interim moving towards the next pastor. Do you know a major responsibility of pastors is to comfort the afflicted and afflict the comfortable? I'm going to say that again, because we like the first part. Major responsibility of pastors is to comfort the afflicted and to afflict the comfortable. Mr. Loy speaks to this when he says, I quote, "The church does not exist to meet your needs. You're a part of a church that exists to meet the needs of the world. So put away the shopping cart and pick up a shovel. You've heard me say this in a different way. When you come to church, leave your bib at home and wear an apron when you come to church. Mr. Loy's making the same point we begin with this morning. You and I cannot live on someone else's oil. You and I cannot expect to go into the wedding feast and celebrate in heaven the new home that God has provided on the coattails of someone else. The second thing that strikes me about this parable is that it's our calling, our responsibility, and really a privilege to be preparing every day of our lives for His return. That is the mirror image of what the five virgins who were ready were doing. They were using every day to always be ready in expectation of His return, not knowing the day or the hour. We have to keep our lamps fed with the oil of the Holy Spirit. Well, that's a great question. Well, okay, well, Tom, what does that look like? What does that mean to keep our oil lamps fed? Well, I would answer that question by asking two more. First, what gifts do we have from God, and are we using them for His kingdom? And the second is this, where has God planted us, and what are we doing there for His kingdom? Let me answer the second first. Where has God planted us, and what are we doing there for His kingdom purposes? You see, the foundational principle for this kind of conversation is this. I think it's to understand and be in agreement that God has planted us where we are. Think about all the places you are. I'll name them in a minute. But God has planted us there. It is God's plan that you are, I am, where we are right now in this season of life. And where we are in that life is no coincidence. Now, on a side note, just in case you are where you are because of a decision you made against God, be thankful He still has a plan for you even in that bad choice. So again, where we are is no coincidence. Think through this with me. I learned this in Peter Scazzaro, Emotionally Healthy Spirituality. Do you understand God placed you in your family? God placed you in your family, in the roles that you have. And so keeping the lamp full, preparing for the Lord's return means that the role we have been given, we need to fulfill that for His purpose, for kingdom's purpose, so that we'll be ready. So, dads, are we fulfilling the role? Moms, sons, daughters, grandparents. We've been placed in that role. Are we living out those roles for the purpose of God's kingdom? What about where God has placed us in our jobs? Whether that job is inside the home or outside the home, I mean, the deal is God has placed us there with a specific reason, and it's a kingdom reason. Are we treating it as such? What about where God has planted us in our stage of life? Right? Early adulthood? Retirement? Widow or widowhood? Being single? God has placed us in that season, in that orientation. And it goes on and on, where we live in the midst of our neighbors. What social groups are we a part of? What are the concentric circles of life where you and I are planted? Because I don't know about you, but I usually go to the same grocery store to buy my groceries and I see the same people. I wonder about my role in the kingdom purpose right there. What about where I bank? What about where I buy gas? What about where I eat in restaurants? You ask those people their names, and God, understanding God, has planted you and me in those circles with kingdom purposes in mind. Let me ask you this question. Is any of this beyond the realm of God to say that His kingdom purpose in us being in those roles and places at any given time belong to Him? Is that beyond the realm of God? I think not. By failing to prepare, we're preparing to fail. But what about the first question? What gifts do we have from God? And are we using them for His kingdom? Oh, I love to see people balk at this. Well, preacher, you don't know me. I don't have any gifts. I don't have any gifts. It's not true. I'm going to tell you the gift right now. If you're a believer, you've got a story. You've got a witness. You've got a testimony. about who you were before God came into your life and who you were when God came in your life and who God is now that he's in your life. That's a gift given by God. You talk about preparing for the bridegroom to come and take his church, you and I. Are we telling our story? Are we sharing this? Every believer has the story of sins, of the sins we've committed and how we're forgiven and we fall under grace. Every believer has the story of failures. Life experiences where we have failed miserably and when we've been disobedient. But God redeemed us and says you're not identified by your failure. I have a new name for you. But this is our story. This is our song. Every believer has spiritual gifts. You know what they are? Are you using them? Every believer has financial means. And you say, well, you don't know how tight my budget is. I don't care. God will put you in the place to use what you have to help somebody else. This is so theological to say this. That's just the way he rolls. Get ready. Oh, there it is, isn't it? Get ready. By failing to prepare, we're preparing to fail. I never want you or me or anyone else listening to ever hear the door shut. Pray with me. Father, into this moment, may you find us faithful and honest with enough integrity to let your spirit roam in our heart and in our mind at this moment. We don't know when you're coming again. But we know now is the time, if we haven't already, to repent and turn our life around and give it to you. Now is the time for us to remember we can't live on anybody else's oil. We can't ride on somebody's coattails into the kingdom of God. We have been placed where we are for kingdom purposes. We have a story. We have gifts. We have possessions. We have experiences in our life. All that enable us to help be prepared and preparing others for your coming again. Bless us as we take this time to respond to this question. What has God said to me in this hour of worship? Amen.
Amen. As we continue in our worship together this morning, we're going to invite you to ask yourself that question. What has God said to you during this time of worship? You know, when I think about this spiritual gifts idea, this reality that we've all been given these gifts to use for the betterment and for the good of God's kingdom. You know, I've often had conversations with people about what that might look like. And one of the things that I've kind of discerned over time is it's something that actually comes rather naturally to someone. And they almost kind of assume that it comes naturally to everyone. And, you know, I remember when we were worshiping at the high school, we did this survey, and people were encouraged to try to discover what those gifts were. And a lot of people were just saying, you know, wow, I mean, I figured everybody enjoyed doing that. And the reality is that not everybody does. And God's created each one of us for a unique purpose, and he's given us these gifts. And collectively, together, we make up the body of Christ. As we have this opportunity to reflect, we'll also have an opportunity to respond. And if you're here today and you have a prayer request or something that we can pray for, I want to encourage you to come forward, write it down on one of these cards, and tack it to this cross. Folks will gather here and pray over these needs. You know, every week it's just awesome to know that these aren't just things that get plastered up there and then someone comes through and cleans and they get tossed. No, they're actually taken down. They're passed around in a group of people who gather here on Mondays to pray for the concerns of the community. If there's someone who's close to you but maybe far from Jesus that you want to pray for this morning, I would invite you to light a candle and pray for them. We also have an opportunity during this time to give back to God that which He's given to us through our tithes and offerings. So if you're here today prepared to do that, we have the box up front here. I would just encourage you to come and to drop your tithe or your offering in the box. You know, we all come to church for different reasons. You know, there was a time in my life when I would come because I kind of felt like I should. Then there was a time where I came because I enjoyed being around the people. Then there was, you know, times where I really loved the messages or really loved the worship music. But the reason that we all come, the reason that we should all be coming, is because of Jesus. And the thing I love about doing communion each week is it really helps to center us around the person of Christ. Because if it wasn't for Jesus, we probably wouldn't be here. Some of us probably wouldn't know each other. We would just be living these lives and going in these other directions. But because of what Christ did, it joins us together as family. The scripture tells us that Jesus was gathered with his disciples, his followers, and they were preparing to have a meal together. And Jesus picked up a loaf of bread, and he broke the loaf of bread, and he gave thanks, and he said to them, "This is my body, broken for you. Take and eat the body of Christ." The scripture goes on to tell the story where Jesus, at the end of the meal, picked up the cup and said that this cup represents his blood, which will be shed for them, his followers then, and us, his followers now, for the forgiveness of our sins, the blood of Christ. Pray with me. God, we thank you for this message this morning, for this challenge. Lord, for this reminder that you created us for a reason and with a purpose. And Father, many times we can get so caught up in the ways of the world and in the thoughts of our own minds that we can stray and wander from that purpose. But Lord, I'm so grateful that you are a God of second chances and third chances and fourth chances, and that you are a God that wants to help us to deconstruct these false narratives and to reconstruct a new narrative as your child in your kingdom. Lord, I thank you that you give us opportunities to rewrite where it is that we're going. Lord, I pray that you would impress upon our hearts this morning the way that you've created us to be ambassadors for your kingdom. Lord, I pray that you would impress upon us that which you have for us this morning, that we would have the ears to hear and the hearts to receive. And Lord, I thank you for this church family. I thank you for my brothers and sisters who are close. And Father, for the opportunity we have to follow you together. Lord, we give you the praise and the glory and the honor. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
I give you control. Consume me from the inside out, Lord. Let justice and praise become my embrace. To love you from the inside out. Everlasting, your light will shine when loveless hates. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all frame. And the cry of my heart is to bring you praise from the inside.
You know, as we prepare to go today, as I was thinking about Tom's message this morning and the fact that we all find ourselves in places and situations, and maybe we can find ourselves thinking about wanting to maybe be like somewhere else, but what if we just all got comfortable with just blooming where we're planted right now? And I think by discovering these gifts and using them, we can make a huge difference regardless of where we find ourselves. We're going to close with our benediction, and I'll remind us that you've come and we've sung these songs, we've heard God's word proclaimed, we've prayed for people, we've given back to God, we've had opportunities to hear the scripture read, and as we go, it's time for the service of the church to begin. So join me in the benediction. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us. To him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. God bless you. Have a great afternoon.